Assalamu alaikum, my dear ladies and gentlemen. In today's lecture, I am going to discuss with you inflammation. So first of all, we are coming to discuss with you definition of inflammation. So inflammation is a local response reaction of living vascularized tissue to the endogenous and exogenous stimuli. The term is derived from the Latin inflammare, meaning to burn. Inflammation is fundamentally destined to localize and eliminate the causative agent and to limit tissue injury. Thus, inflammation is a physiologic protective response to injury. An observation made by Sir John Hunter in 1794 concluded, inflammation is itself not to consider as a disease but as a salutary operation consequent either to some violence, to some or to some diseases. Causes of inflammation are apparently causes of a disease such as physical agent in mechanical injury, alteration in temperature and pressure, radiation injuries, chemical agent including the ever increasing list of drugs and toxin, biologic agent include bacteria, viruses, fungi, parasites. Immunologic disorders include hypersensitivity reaction, autoimmunity, immunodeficiency states, etc. Genetic metabolic disorder example are gout, diabetes mellitus. So now we are coming to discuss with you nomenclature of inflammation. The nomenclature of inflammatory lesion are usually indicated by the suffix -itis. Thus, inflammation of the appendix is called appendicitis, and that of meninges is meningitis, etc. However, like any rule, it has its own exception. Example are pneumonia, typhoid, fever, etc. So now we are coming to discuss with you classification of inflammation. So in classification of inflammation is classified crudely based on duration of the lesion and histologic appearance into acute and chronic inflammation. So now we are coming to discuss with you acute inflammation. What is acute inflammation? So acute inflammation is an immediate and early response to an injurious agent, and it is relatively of short duration, lasting for minutes, several hours or few days. It is characterized by exudation of fluid and plasma protein and the immigration of predominantly neutrophilic leukocyte to the site of injury. Now we are coming to discuss with you the five cardinal signs of acute inflammation. So in this, redness, also called rubor, which is due to the dilation of small blood vessel within damaged tissue as it occurs in cellulitis, heat called Kehler, also called Kehler, which result from increased blood flow, hyperemia due to renal vascular dilation, swelling, which is also called tumor, which is due to the accumulation of fluid in extravascular space, which is in turn is due to increased vascular permeability, pain, which is also called dolor, which partially result from the stretching and destruction of tissues due to inflammatory edema and infarct from first under pressure. In abscess cavity, some chemical of acute inflammation including bradykinin, prostaglandin and serotonin are also known to induce pain. So now we are coming to discuss with you loss of function. So the loss of function is the inflamed area is inhibited by pain, while severe swelling may also physically immobilize the tissue. Now we are coming to discuss with you even of acute inflammation. Acute inflammation is characterized into early vascular and a late cellular response. The vascular response has the following step: immediate, also called momentary, vasoconstriction in second due to neurogenic or chemical stimuli, vasodilation of arteriole and venule resulting in increased blood flow. After the phase of increased blood flow, there is showing of blood flow and stasis due to increased vascular permeability. That is most remarkably seen in post-capillary venule. The increased vascular permeability oozes protein-rich fluid, into extravascular tissue due to this, the already dilated blood vessels are now packed with red blood cells, resulting in stasis, the protein-rich fluid, which is now found in the extravascular space is called exudate. What is called exudate? Extravascular space in which protein fluid is found is called exudate. The presence of exudates clinically appear as swelling, chemical mediator, mediate the vascular event of acute inflammation. So we are coming to discuss with you cellular response. The cellular response has the following stages: migration, ruling, fermenting and adhesion of leukocyte, transmigration of leukocyte, chemotaxis, phagocytosis. Normally blood cell, particularly erythrocyte in venules, are confined to the central zone and plasma assume the peripheral zone as a result of increased vascular permeability. So see vascular permeability even above. More and more neutrophil accumulate along the endothelial surface peripheral zone. So now we are coming to discuss with you migration, ruling, fermenting and adhesion of leukocyte. Migration is the peripheral position of white cell along the endothelial cell. Subsequently rows of leukocyte tumble slowly along the endothelium in a process known as ruling. In time the endothelium can be virtually lined by white cell. The appearance is called fermenting. Thereafter, the binding of leukocyte with endothelial cell is facilitated by cell adhesion molecules such as selectin, immunoglobulin, integrin, etc., which result in adhesion of leukocyte with the endothelium. Now we are coming to discuss with you transmigration of leukocyte. So leukocyte escape from minute and small vein, but only occasionally from capillaries. The movement of leukocyte by extending pseudopodia through the vascular wall occur by the process called diapedesis. What is called diapedesis? Diapedesis is a process by which leukocyte escape from minute and small vein, but only occasionally from capillaries. The most important mechanism of leukocyte immigration is via widening of intraendothelial junction after endothelial cell contraction. The basement membrane is disrupted and resealed thereafter immediately. Now we are coming to discuss with you chemotaxis, a unidirectional attraction of leukocytes from vascular channel toward the site of inflammation within the tissue space guided by chemical gradient. So including bacteria and cellular debris is called chemotaxis. What is called chemotaxis? Chemotaxis is a unidirectional attraction of leukocytes from vascular channel to the site of inflammation within the tissue. The most important chemotactic factor for neutrophil are component of the complement system. C5a, bacterial and mitochondrial product of arachidonic acid metabolism, such as leukotriene B4 and cytokines IL-8, all granulocyte, monocyte and to lesser extent lymphocyte respond to chemotactic stimuli. How do leukocytes see or smell the chemotactic agent? This is because the receptor on cell membrane of the leukocyte react with the chemo attractant, resulting in the activation of phospholipase C that ultimately lead to the release of cytochoric calcium ions, and these ions trigger cell movement towards the stimuli. Now we are coming to discuss with you phagocytosis. What is phagocytosis? Phagocytosis is a process of engulfment and internalization by special cell. A participate material which include invading microorganism, damaged cell and tissue debris. These phagocytic cells include fully morphonuclear leukocyte, particularly neutrophil, monocyte and tissue macrophages. Phagocytosis involves three distinct but interrelated steps: recognition and attachment of the particle to be ingested by the leukocyte. Phagocytosis is enhanced if the material to be phagocytosed is coated with certain plasma protein called opsonin. These opsonin promote the adhesion between the particulate material and the phagocytic cell membrane. The three major opsonin are the Fc fragment of the immunoglobulin component of the complement system C3b and C3bi, and the carbohydrate binding protein lectin. Thus, IgG bind to receptor for the Fc phase of the immunoglobulin FcR, whereas 3cb and 3bi are ligand for complementary receptors CR1 and CR2 respectively. Now we are coming to discuss with you engulfment. During engulfment, extension of the cytoplasm, so the force flow around the object to be engulfed, eventually resulting in complete enclosure of the particle within the phagosome created by the cytoplasmic membrane of the phagocytic cell. As a result of fusion between the phagosome and lysosome, a phagolysome is formed, and the engulfed particle exposed to the degradative lysosome enzyme. Now we are coming to discuss with you killing or degradation. The ultimate step in phagocytosis of bacteria is killing and degradation. There are two forms of bacterial killing, oxygen independent. In this, first is oxygen independent mechanism. This is a moderated by some of the constituent of the primary and secondary granule of pooling morphonuclear leukocyte. These include bacterial permeability, increasing protein BPI, lysozyme, lactoferrin, major basic protein defense. It is probably that bacterial killing by the lysosome enzyme is incipient and relatively unimportant compared with the oxygen dependent mechanism. The lysosome enzyme are, however, essential for the degradation of dead organism within the phagosome. In second step is oxygen dependent mechanism. So in oxygen dependent mechanism, there are two types of oxygen dependent killing mechanism. In this, first is non-myeloperoxidase dependent. The oxygen dependent killing of the microorganism is due to the formation of reactive oxygen species such as hydrogen peroxide, H2O2, superoxide, O2, and hydroxyl ion, HO negative, and possibly single oxygen, O2. These species have single unpaired electron in their outer orbit that react with molecule in cell membrane or nucleus to cause damages. The destructive effect of H2O2 in the body are gauged by the action of the glutathione peroxide and catalase. In second phase, there are myeloperoxidase dependent. The bacterial activity of H2O2 involve the lysosomal enzyme myeloperoxidase, which is in the presence of halide ion, convert H2O2 to the hypochlorous acid, HOCl. This H2O2 halide myeloperoxidase system is the most efficient bactericidal system in neutrophil. A similar mechanism is also effective against fungi, viruses, protozoa, and helminths. Like the vascular event, the cellular event, i.e. the adhesion, the transmigration, the chemotoxicity and the phagocytosis are activated by the chemical mediator. Next, we will focus on the source of these mediator. So, chemical mediator of inflammation include, account for the event of inflammation. Inflammation is the following sequence: cellular cell injury, chemical mediator, acute inflammation. For example, the vascular and cellular event. So now we are coming to discuss with you sources of mediator. The chemical mediator of inflammation can be derived from plasma or cell. Plasma derived mediator include complement activation, increase vascular permeability C3a, C5a, activate chemotoxicity C5a, opsonization C3b, C3bi, pector pector 12, Higman pector activation. Its activation results in the requirement of pore system, the kinin, the clotting of fibrinolytic, and the complement system. So now we are coming to discuss with you cell-derived chemical mediator. So cell-derived chemical mediator include, so this is the mediator, these are the principal source of mediator, and this is the action which are taken by the mediator. So histamine, mast cell, basophil, platelets, these take action, their action are vasodilation, increased vascular permeability, endothelial activation. So serotonin, their principal source are platelets, and their action are vasodilation, increased vascular permeability, vasodilation, prostaglandin, their principal source are mast cell, leukocyte, and their action are vasodilation, pain, fever. Leukotriene, their principal source are mast cell, leukocyte, and their action are increased vascular permeability, chemotaxis, leukocyte adhesion and activation. Platelet activating factor, their principal source are leukocyte, mast cell, and their action are vasodilation, increased vascular permeability, leukocyte adhesion, chemotaxis, degranulation, oxidative burst. Reactive oxygen species, their principal source are leukocyte, and their action are killing up microbes, tissue damage. Nitric oxide, their principal source are endothelium macrophages, and their action are vascular smooth muscle relaxation, killing up microbes. Cytokines, tumor necrosis factor. Interleukin, their principal source are macrophages, endothelial cell, mast cell, and their action are local endothelial activation, expression of adhesion molecule. Fever, pain, anorexia, hypotension, decreased vascular resistance, shock. Chemokines, their principal source are leukocyte activation macrophages, and their action are chemotaxis, leukocyte activation. Plasma protein derived mediator are complement products C5A, C3A, C4A. Their principal source are plasma produced in liver, and their action are leukocyte, chemotaxis and activation, vasodilation, mast cell stimulation. Kinins, their principal source are plasma produced in liver, and their action are increased vascular permeability, smooth muscle contraction, vasodilation, pain. Protease, activating during coagulation, their principal source are plasma produced in liver, and their action are endothelial activation, leukocyte requirement. So most mediators perform their biologic activities by initially binding to a specific receptor on target cell. Once activated and relaxed from the cell, most of these mediators are short-lived. Most mediators have the potential to cause harmful effect. So now we are coming to discuss with you morphology of acute inflammation. Characteristically, the acute inflammation response involves production exudates and exudate is an edema fluid with high protein concentration which frequently contains inflammatory cell. Untransudate is simply a non-inflammatory edema caused by cardiac, renal, undernutritional or in other disorder. The difference between the an exudate and untransudate are, so feed transudate and exudate. So in Francis Peter, their transudate are passive increased pressure and exudate are in active inflammation. Vascular permeability Peter include transudate normal, exudate increase. Plasma protein leak feeder include, in this transudate is absent and exudate is present. Protein content of fluid feeder in this transudate are low SG, then 1012 protein is more than 1.5 gram per deciliter, and their exudate are high SG, higher than 1020, and their protein are more than 1.5 gram per deciliter. Sari intransitrate, their protein are low than 1.5 gram per deciliter. Fibrin feeder, there in this transitrate is absent and exudate is present. Inflammatory cell feeder include, and this transitrate is absent and exudate is present. So there are different morphologic types of acute inflammation, serious inflammation. This is characterized by an outpouring of a thin fluid that is derived from either the blood serum or secretion of mesothelial cell lining the peritoneal, fluvular, and pericardial cavities. It resolves without reaction. So now we are coming to discuss with you fibrinous inflammation, more severe injury resulting in greater vascular permeability that ultimately lead to exudation of larger molecules such as fibrinogen through the vascular barrier. Fibrinous exudate is the characteristic of inflammation in serious body cavities such as the pericardium. Butter and bread appearance and fluvia, course of fibrin inflammatory include resolution of fibrinolysis, scar formation between peritoneal and visceral surface, i.e. the exudates get organized. Fibrous strain formation that breach the pericardial space. So now we are coming to discuss with you suppurative inflammation or purulent inflammation. This type of inflammation is characterized by the production of large amount of pus. What is pus? Pus is a thick, creamy liquid, yellowish or blood stain in color and composed of the following matter, which we will discuss in next lecture. Goodbye, my dear ladies and gentlemen. If you like my lecture, so please subscribe. Hello dear ladies and gentlemen, today we will discuss about non-nonopoid analgesic, antipyretics and NSAIDs are a broad group of pain medication. They are discussed together because in addition to pain control, they also produce antipyretics, fever control and anti-inflammatory effects. These drugs may be used alone or in combination with other medications. They have a ceiling effect, maximum dose above which there no added benefit and don't cause physical dependence. The drug classes included in this group are salicylates, especially aspirin, which are widely used, the para-aminophenol derivative, acetaminophen, NSAID, the urinary tract analgesic, phenazepridine. So dear ladies and gentlemen, now we are coming to discuss with you salicylates. Salicylates are among the most commonly used pain medication. They are used regularly to control pain and reduce fever and inflammation, and they are cheap, easy and reliable. Salicylates usually cost less than other analgesic and are readily available without a prescription. Aspirin is the most commonly used salicylate. Other common salicylates include choline magnesium trisalicylate, choline salicylate, diflunisal salicylate, sodium salicylate. So dear ladies and gentlemen, now we are coming to discuss with you pharmacokinetics, that how drugs circulate. Taken orally, salicylate are absorbed partially in the stomach but primarily in the upper part of the small intestine. The pure and buffered form of aspirin are absorbed readily but sustained release and enteric coated salicylate preparation are absorbed more slowly. Poor food and antacid in the stomach also delay absorption. Salicylate given rectally have a slower, more erratic absorption. So we are coming to discuss with you distribution, metabolism, and the excretion of non-effort analgesic salicylate. So salicylate are distributed widely throughout body tissue and fluid, including breast milk. In addition, they easily cross the placental barrier. The liver extensively metabolizes salicylate into several metabolites. The kidney excretes the metabolites along with some unchanged drug. Now we are coming to discuss the pharmacodynamics, how drug act. The different effect of salicylate stem from their separate mechanism of action. They relieve pain primarily by inhibiting the synthesis of prostaglandin. Recall that prostaglandin is a chemical mediator that synthesizes nerve cell to pain. In addition, they may also reduce inflammation by inhibiting the prostaglandin synthesis and release that occur during inflammation. They are hot and bothered. Salicylate reduce fever by stimulating the hypothalamus, producing dilation of the peripheral blood vessel and increased sweating. This promotes heat loss through the skin and cooling by evaporation. Also, because prostaglandin E increase body temperature, inhibiting its production, lower a fever. No clots allowed. One salicylate aspirin permanently inhibit platelets aggregation. The clumping of platelets to form a clot by interfering with the production of a substance called thromboxane, A2 necessarily for platelets aggregation. Not all salicylates have the effect. This effect, for example, choline magnesium doesn't increase bleeding time. Now we are coming to discuss with you pharmacotherapeutics, that how drugs are used. Salicylates are used primarily to relieve pain and reduce fever. However, they don't effectively relieve visceral pain. Pain from the organ and smooth muscle, or severe pain from trauma. For example, you give me a fever. Salicylate won't reduce a normal body temperature. They can reduce an elevated body temperature and will relieve headache and muscle ache at the same time. What kind of joint is this? Salicylate can provide considerable relief in 24 hours when they are used to reduce inflammation in rheumatic fever, rheumatoid arthritis, and osteoarthritis. Go with the flow. As a result of the anti-clotting properties, aspirin can be used to enhance blood flow during myocardial infection and to prevent recurrence of myocardial infection. How long can you go? No matter with the clinical indication, the main guideline of salicylate therapy is to use the lowest dose that provides relief. This reduces the likelihood of adverse reaction. See adverse reaction to salicylate. Drug interaction. Because salicylates are highly protein bound, they can interact with many other protein-bound drugs by displacing those drugs from sites to which they normally bind. This increases the serum concentration of the unbound active drug, causing increased pharmacologic effect. The unbound drug is said to be potentiated. The following drugs interaction may occur: oral anticoagulant heparin, methotrexate, oral anti-diabetic agent, and insulin are among the drugs that have an increased effect or risk of toxicity with taken with salicylate. Probenecid, sulfine, pirazone, and spironolactone may have a decreased effect when taken with salicylate. Corticosteroid may decrease plasma salicylate level and increase the risk of ulcer. Alkalinizing drug and antacid may reduce salicylate level. The antihypertensive effect of angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitor and beta adrenergic blocker may be reduced when these drugs are combined with salicylate. NSAIDs may have a reduced therapeutic effect and an increased risk of gastrointestinal effect when taken with salicylate. Now we are coming to discuss with you acetaminophen. Although the class of para-aminophenol derivatives include two drugs, phenacetin and acetaminophen, only acetaminophen is available in the United States. Acetaminophen is an OTC drug that produces analgesic and antipyretic effect. It appears in many products designed to relieve the pain and symptom associated with cold and influenza. Now we are coming to discuss with you pharmacokinetics of acetaminophen. Acetaminophen is absorbed rapidly and completely from the gastrointestinal tract. It's also absorbed well from the mucous membrane of the rectum. So their distribution, metabolism, and excretion of acetaminophen acetaminophen is distributed widely in body fluid and readily cross the placental barrier. After acetaminophen is metabolized by the liver, it's excreted by the kidney and is in small amount in breast milk. So now we are coming to discuss with you the pharmacodynamics of acetaminophen. So acetaminophen reduces pain and fever, but unlike salicylate, it doesn't affect inflammation or platelet function. It can cause anticoagulation in the patient taking warfarin. Now we are coming to discuss with you myasthenia theater. The pain control effect of acetaminophen aren't well understood. The drug may work in the central nervous system by inhibiting prostaglandin synthesis, and in the peripheral nervous system in some unknown way. It reduces fever by acting directly on the heat regulating center in the hypothalamus. So now we are coming to discuss with you pharmacotherapeutics. Acetaminophen is used to reduce fever and relieve headache, muscle ache, and general pain. Child play. Acetaminophen is the drug of choice to treat fever and flu-like symptoms in children. Additionally, the American Arthritis Association has indicated the acetaminophen as an effective pain reliever for some types of arthritis. Their drugs interaction are: acetaminophen can reduce the pulmonary drug interaction, the effect of oral anticoagulant and thrombolytic drugs may be slightly increased. The risk of liver toxicity is increased when long-term alcohol use, pentuin, barbiturates, carbamazepin, and isoniazids are combined with acetaminophen. The effect of lamotrigine, loop diuretics, and zidovudine may be reduced when these drugs are taken with acetaminophen. So now we are coming to discuss with you non-steroidal and anti-inflammatory drugs. As their name suggested, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, NSAIDs, are short form of this, are typically used to combat inflammation. Their anti-inflammatory action equal that of aspirin. They also have analgesic and antipyretic effect. Unlike aspirin effect, the effect of NSAIDs or platelet aggregation are temporary. So there are two types of NSAIDs, selective and non-selective, also called FICCI. The non-selective NSAIDs include diclofenac, idolac, fenofibrin, flubiprofen, ibuprofen, indomethacin, ketoprofen, ketorolac, meloxicam, nabometone, naproxen, oxaproxen, piroxicam, and sulindac. The only selective NSAIDs available on today's market is Silisoxib. Their pharmacokinetics are: all NSAIDs are non-selective and selective are absorbed in the gastrointestinal tract.
They are mostly metabolized in the liver and excreted primarily by the kidney. Their thermodynamics are two isoenzymes of clooxygenase known as COX-1 and COX-2 convert arachidonic acid into prostaglandin. The non-selective NSAID block both COX-1 and COX-2. Selective NSAID block only the COX-2 enzyme. Heart to stomach. The prostaglandin produced by COX-1 maintains the stomach lining, while those produced by COX-2 cause inflammation. That's why the non-selective NSAID which inhibit COX-1 along with COX-2 commonly cause gastrointestinal adverse effects. Selective NSAID, however, elevate pain and inflammation without causing significant gastrointestinal adverse effect because they inhibit only COX-2. So now we are coming to discuss with you the pharmacotherapeutics of NSAID. NSAID are used primarily to decrease inflammation. They are secondary used to relieve pain, but are seldom prescribed to reduce fever. COX-2 inhibit are primarily used to relieve pain and to decrease inflammation. These drugs are particularly useful in the treatment of osteoarthritis, rheumatoid arthritis, acute pain, primarily dysmenorrhea and familial adenomatous polyposis. So now we are coming to discuss call and response of the NSAID. The following condition respond favorably to treatment with NSAID. Ankylosing spondylitis and inflammatory joint disease that first affect the spine. Moderate to severe rheumatoid arthritis and inflammatory disease of peripheral joint. Osteoarthritis, a degenerative joint disease in the hip, shoulder or other large joint. Osteoarthritis accompanied by inflammation. Acute gouty arthritis, urate deposit in the joint. Dysmenorrhea, painful menstruation, migraine headache, bursitis, and tendinitis, mild to moderate pain. So now we are coming to discuss with you their drug interaction. A wide variety of drugs can interact with NSAID, especially with indomethacin, piroxicam, and sulindac. Because they are highly protein-bound, NSAID are likely to interact with other protein-bound drugs. Such drugs are fluconazole, phenobarbital, rifampin, ritonavir, and salicylate affect absorption of NSAID, whereas NSAID affect the absorption of such drugs as oral anticoagulant aminoglycosides, as inhibitor, beta adrenergic blocker, digoxin, dilantin, and many other. Because NSAID are metabolized by the liver, drug-drug interaction have been identified for all of them. For example, these drugs decrease the clearance of lithium, which can result in the lithium toxicity. They also reduce the anti-hypertensive effect of ACE inhibitor and diuretics. So that's all, dear ladies and gentlemen. If you like my presentation, please subscribe and share with others and press the bell icon. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajeem. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Hello dear ladies and gentlemen. Today I will discuss with you about healing. So first of all, I am coming to discuss with you the definition of the healing. The word healing used in a pathological context refers to the body replacement of destroyed tissue by living tissue. So process of healing occur in the following way. The healing process involves two distinct processes: regeneration, the replacement of lost tissue by tissue similar in type, and repair, healing by scarring, the replacement of lost tissue by granulation tissue with which mature to palm scar tissue healing by fibrils is innervated with the surrounding specialized cell do not possess the capacity to proliferate. Whether healing takes place by regeneration or by repair is determined partly by type of cell in the damaged organ or partly by the destruction or the intactness of the stromal framework of the organ. Hence, it is important to know the types of cell in the body. So now we are coming to discuss with you the type of cell in the body. Based on their proliferative capacity, there are three types of cell. First is labile cell. These are cells which have a continuous turn or by programmed division of stem cell. They are found in the surface epithelium of the gastrointestinal tract, urinary tract or the skin. The cell of lymphoid and hemophytic system are further example of labile cell. The chances of regeneration are excellent. On second stage comes stable cell. Tissue which have such type of cell have normally a much lower level of replication and there are few stem cells. However, the cell of such tissues can undergo rapid division in response to injury. For example, mesenchymal cell, such as smooth muscle cell, fibroblast, osteoblast, and endothelial cell are stable cell, which can proliferate. Liver, endocrine gland, and renal tubular epithelium has also such type of cell, which can regenerate. Their chances of regeneration are good. So now we are coming to discuss with you permanent cell. So these are non-dividing cell. If lost, permanent cell cannot be replaced because they do not have the capacity of proliferate. Example of permanent cell are adult neuron, striated muscle cell and cell of the lens. Having been introduced to the types of cell, we can go back to the types of the healing process and elaborate them. So we are coming to discuss with you healing process by regeneration. Definition of regeneration, actually generate means bring to life, is the renewal of lost tissue in which the lost cell are replaced by identical ones. So we will discuss regeneration involve two process. On first stage come proliferation of surviving cell to replace lost of tissue. On second step come migration of the surviving cell into the vacant space. The capacity of a tissue for regeneration depends on its proliferative ability, degree of damage to stromal framework, and on the type of and severity of the damage. Tissue form of labile and stable cell can regenerate provided their stromal framework are intact. So now we are coming to discuss with you repair healing by connective tissue. Definition of repair are, repair is the orderly process by which lost tissue is eventually replaced by a scar, a wound in which only the lining epithelium is affected to heal exclusively by regeneration. In the contrast, wound that extend through the basement membrane to the connective tissue. Example of the repair are, the dermis in the skin or the submucosa in the gastrointestinal tract lead to the formation of granulation tissue and eventually scarring. Tissue containing terminally differentiated permanent cells such as neuron and skeletal muscle cell cannot heal by regeneration. Rather, the lost permanent cell are replaced by formation of granulation tissue. In the granulation tissue formation, three phases may be observed. On first step come phase of inflammation. At this phase, inflammatory exudate containing polymorphs is seen in the area of a tissue injury. In addition, there is platelet aggregation and fibrin deposition. On second step come phase of demolition. The dead cell liberate their autolytic enzyme and other enzyme proteolytic come from disintegrating polymorphs. There is an associated macrophage in infiltration. These cell ingest particulate matter, either digesting or removing it. In growth of granulation tissue, this is characterized by proliferation of fibroblasts and in growth of a new blood vessel into the area of induity with a variable number of inflammatory cells. Fibroblasts actively synthesize and secrete extracellular matrix components including fibronectin, proteoglycans, and collagen types 1 and type 3. The fibronectin and proteoglycan form the scaffolding for rebuilding of the matrix. Fibronectin bind to fibrin and act as a chemotactic factor for the recruitment of more fibroblasts and macrophages. The synthesis of collagen by fibroblasts begin within 24 hours of the injury, although its deposition in the tissue is not apparent until 4 days. By day 5, collagen type 3 is the predominant matrix protein being produced, but by day 7 to 8, type 1 is prominent and is eventually become the major collagen of mature scar tissue. This type 1 collagen is responsible for providing the tensile strength of the matrix in a scar, coincident with fibroblast proliferation. There is angiogenesis, new vascularization, a proliferation and formation of new small blood vessels. Vascular proliferation starts 48 to 72 hours after injury and lasts for several days. With further healing, there is an increase in extracellular constituent, mostly collagen, with a decrease in the number of active fibroblasts and new vessels, despite an increased collagen activity in the wound, which are responsible for the removal of built collagen. Collagen accumulates at a steady rate, usually reaching a maximum 2 to 3 months after the injury. The tensile strength of the wounds continues to increase many months after the collagen content has reached a maximum. As the collagen content of the wound increases, many of the newly formed vessels disappear. This vascular inulation, which takes place in a few weeks, dramatically transforms a richly vascularized tissue into a pale, a vascular scar tissue. Now we are coming to discuss with you wound contraction. So wound contraction is a mechanical reduction in the size of a defect. The wound is reduced approximately by 70 to 80% of its original size. Contraction results in much faster healing, since only one quarter to one third of the amount of destroyed tissue has to be replaced. If contraction is prevented, healing is slow and a largely ugly scar is formed. Causes of contraction are: it is said to be due to contraction by myofibroblasts. Myofibroblasts have the feature intermediate between those of fibroblasts and smooth muscle cells. 2 to 3 days after the injury, they migrate into the wound and their active contraction decreases the size of the defect. So we are coming to discuss with you molecular control of healing process. As seen above, healing involves an orderly sequence of events, which includes regeneration and migration of specialized cell, angiogenesis, proliferation of fibroblasts and related cell matrix protein synthesis, and finally cessation of these processes. These processes, at least in part, are mediated by a series of low molecular weight polypeptide ripple to a growth factor. These growth factors have the capacity to stimulate cell division and proliferation. Some of the factors known to play a role in the healing process are briefly discussed below. Sources of growth factor are: following injury, growth factor may be derived from a number of sources, such as platelets activated after endothelial damage, damaged epithelial cell, circulating serum growth factor, macrophages or lymphocyte required to the area of the injury.
The healing process sees when last tissue has been replaced. The mechanism regulating this process are not fully understood. TGF beta act as a growth inhibitor for both epithelial and endothelial cell and regulate their regeneration. So now I am coming to discuss with you wound healing. The two processes of healing described above can occur during healing of disease organ or during healing of a wound. What is wound? A wound can be accidental or surgical. Now we will discuss 10 wound healing to demonstrate the two basic processes of healing mentioned above. Healing of a wound demonstrates both epithelial regeneration, healing of the epidermis, and repair by scarring healing of the dermis. There are two patterns of wound healing. Depending on the amount of tissue damage, healing by first intention, primary union, healing by second intention, secondary union. These two patterns are essentially the same process, varying only in the amount. Now I am coming to discuss with you healing by first intention or primary union. The least complicated example of the wound healing is the healing of a clean surgical incision. The wound is approximated by surgical suture and healing occurs with minimal loss of tissue. Such healing is referred to surgically as primary union or healing by first intention. The incision caused the death of a limited number of epithelial cells as well as epidermal adnexa and connective tissue cell. The incisional space is narrow and immediately filled with clotted blood containing fibrin and blood cell. Dehydration of the surface clots form the well-known scab that covers the wound and seal it from the environment almost at once within 24 hours. Neutrophil appear at the margin of the incision, moving toward the fibrin clot. The epidermis at its cut edge thicken as a result of mitotic activity of the basal cell. And within 24 to 48 hours, super up the epithelial cell from the edge both migrate and grow along the cut margin of the dermis and beneath the surface caves to fuse in the midline, thus producing a continuous but thin epithelial layer. By the day 3, the neutrophil have been largely replaced by macrophages. Granulation tissue progressively invades the incisional space. Collagen fiber are now present in the margin of the incisional, but these are vertically oriented and do not bridge the incisional. Epithelial cell proliferation continues, thickening the epidermal covering layer. By day 5, the incisional space is filled with granulation tissue. Neovascularization is maximal. Collagen fibrils become more abundant and begin to bright the incision. The epidermis recovers its normal thickness and differentiation of surface cell yield a mature epidermal architecture with surface keratinization. During the second week, there is continued accumulation of collagen and proliferation of fibroblast, leukocyte infiltrate, edema, and increased vascularity have largely disappeared. At this time, the long process of blanching begin accomplished by the increased accumulation of collagen within the incisional scar, accompanied by regression of vascular channel. By the end of the first month, the scar comprises a cellular connective tissue devoid of the inflammatory infiltrate, covered now by an intact epidermis. The dermal appendages, they have been destroyed in the line of the incision, are permanently lost. Tensile strain of the wound increase thereafter, but it makes months for the wound area to obtain its maximal strength. Now I am coming to discuss with you healing by second intention or secondary union. When there is more extensive loss of cell and tissue occur in an infection, inflammatory ulceration, abscesses formation and surface wound that create largely defect
The reparative process is more complicated. The common denominator in all these situations is a large tissue defect that must be filled. Regeneration of parenchymal cell cannot completely reconstitute the original architecture. Abandoned granulation tissue grows in form the margin to complete the repair. This form of healing is referred to as secondary union or healing by second intention. Secondary healing differ from primary healing in several respects, which are inevitably large tissue defect initially have more fibrin and more necrotic debris and exudate that must be removed. Consequently, the inflammatory reaction is more intense. And second step are much larger amount of granulation tissue or form with a large defect occur in deeper tissue, such as in a viscous granulation tissue, bear the full responsibility for its closure because drainage to the surface cannot occur. And third step come, perhaps the feature that most clearly differentiate primary from secondary healing is the phenomena of wound contraction, which occur in largely surface wound. Healing by second intention takes much longer than when it's occur by first intention. Now I am coming to discuss with you factors that influence wound healing. A number of factors can alter the rate and efficiency of healing. These can be classified into those which act locally and those which have systematic effects. Most of these factors have been established in studies of skin wound healing, but many are likely to be of relevance to healing or other sites. Now I am coming to discuss with you local factor of wound healing. So their type, size and location of the wound are: a clean aseptic wound reproduced by the surgeon, scalpel heal faster than a wound produced by abdominal trauma, which exhibit abundant necrosis. As in my previous lecture I discussed with you, necrosis is a cell death, a naturally occurring of a cell death, and irregular is small blunt wound heal faster than large wound. Injuries is richly vascularized area, e.g. the face, heal faster than those in poorly vascularized one, e.g. the foot. In area where the skin adhere to bony surface, as in injuries over the tibia, wound contraction and adequate apposition of the edge are difficult, hence such wound heals slowly. Now I am coming to discuss with you vascular supply to the wound healing. Wound with impaired blood supply heal slowly. For example, the healing of leg wound in patient with varicose vein is prolonged ischemia due to the pressure produced blood source and then prevent their healing. Ischemia due to arterial obstruction happen in the lower extremities of diabetes also prevent healing. Now I am coming to discuss with you infection. So what is infection? Infection is wound provide a portal of entry for microorganism. Infection delay or prevent healing, promote the formation of excessive granulation tissue, proud flesh, and may result in large deforming scar. Now I am coming to discuss with you moment. So what is moment? Moment is the early motion, particularly before tensile strength has been established, subject a wound to persistent trauma, thus preventing or retarding healing. Now I am coming to discuss with you ionizing radiation. So what is ionizing radiation? Ionizing radiation are prior irradiation leaves vascular lesion that interfere with blood supply and result in slow wound healing. Acutely irradiation of a wound blocks cell proliferation, inhibit contraction and retard the formation of granulation tissue. Now I am coming to discuss with you systematic picture of the wound healing.
So and positive comes circulatory status, cardiovascular status by determining the blood supply to the injured area is important for wound healing. Poor healing attribute to old age is often due to largely to impaired circulation. Now I am coming to discuss with you in fiction of the wound healing, of the systematic pattern of the wound healing. So systematic infection delay wound healing. So in this metabolic status are poorly controlled diabetes mellitus is associated with delayed wound healing. The risk of infection is in clean wound, approach biofood, the risk in non-diabetics. In diabetic patient there can be impaired circulation secondary to arteriosclerosis and impaired sensation due to diabetic neuropathy. The impaired sensation rendered to the lower extremity blind in to everyday hazard. Hence in diabetic patient wound heal in the is very slowly. Now I am coming to discuss with you nutritional deficiencies. So on first team other protein deficiency, in protein depletion there is an impairment of granulation tissue and collagen formation resulting in a great delay in wound healing. So on second step come vitamin deficiency. Vitamin C is required for collagen synthesis and secretion. It is required in hydroxylation of prolein and lysine in the process of collagen synthesis. Vitamin C deficiency result in grossly deficient wound healing with the lack of vascular proliferation and collagen deposition. Now I am coming to discuss with you trace element deficiency. Zinc, a co-product of several enzyme deficiency will retard healing by preventing cell proliferation. Zinc is necessary in several DNA and RNA polymerases and transferases. Hence a deficiency state will inhibit mitosis proliferation of fibroblasts. Fibroblasia is therefore retarded. Now I am coming to discuss with you hormones. So what is hormone? So in corticosteroid impair wound healing, an effect attribute to inhibition of collagen synthesis. However, these hormones have many other effects including anti-inflammatory action and a general depletion of protein synthesis. It also inhibits fibroplasia and neovascularization. Both epithelialization and contraction are impaired. It is therefore difficult to attribute their inhibition of wound healing to any one specific mechanism. So thyroid hormone, androgen, estrogen and growth hormone are also influence wound healing. This effect, however, may be more due to their regulation of general metabolic status rather than to a specific modification of the wound healing process. So now I am coming to discuss with you anti-inflammatory drugs. So anti-inflammatory medication do not interfere with wound healing when administered with the usual daily dosage, aspirin and endomethaline. Both inhibit prostaglandin synthesis and thus delay healing. Complication of wound healing are abnormalities in any of three basic healing process. Contraction, reappear, repair and regeneration result in the complication of wound healing. So now I am coming to discuss with you infection. So infection is a wound healing may provide the portal of entry for many organisms. Infection may delay healing and if sewer stop it completely. So now I am coming to discuss with you deficient scar formation. Inadequate formation of granulation tissue or inability to form a suitable extracellular matrix leads to deficient scar formation and its complication. The complication of deficient scar formation are wound dehiscence and incisional hernia ulceration. Now I am coming to discuss with you wound dehiscence and incisional hernias. The essence of bursting of a womb is of most concern after abdominal surgery. If insufficient extracellular matrix is deposited or there is inadequate cross-linking of the matrix, weak scar result. Dehiscence occur in 0.5% to 5% of abdominal operation. Inappropriate suture, maternal or enforced surgical technique are important factor. Wound infection increase mechanical stress on the wound form from vomiting, coughing or illness is a factor. In most cases of abdominal dehiscence, systemic factor that predispose to dehiscence include poor metabolic status such as vitamin C deficiency, hypoproteinemia, and the general inanition that often accompanies metastatic cancer. Dehiscence of the abdominal wall can be life-threatening complication in some studies, carrying a mortality as high as 30%. An incisional hernia, usually of the abdominal wall, refer to a defect caused by four wound healing following surgery into which the intestinal protrude. Now I am coming to discuss with you ulceration. Wound ulcerate because of an inadequate intrinsic blood supply or insufficient vascularization during healing. Example of ulceration are leg wound in person with varicose vein or severe atherosclerosis, typically ulcerate. Non-healing wound also develop in area devoid of sensation because of persistent trauma. Such traumatic or neuropathic ulcer are occasionally seen in patients with leprosy, diabetic peripheral neuropathy, and in tertiary sepals from spinal involvement in tapes dorsalis. Now I am coming to discuss with you excessive scar formation. So excessive deposition of extracellular matrix at the wound site result in hypertrophic scar or keloid. The rate of collagen synthesis, the ratio of type 3 to type 1 collagen, and the number of reducible or cross-linking remain high. A situation that indicate a maturation arrest or block in the healing process. Now I am coming to discuss with you keloid formation. So keloid is an excessive formation of collagen tissue result in the appearance of raised area of a scar tissue called keloid. It is an exuberant scar that tend to progress and recur after excision. The cause of this is unknown. Genetic predisposition, repeated trauma and irritation caused by foreign body hair, keratin, etc. may play a part. It is especially frequent after burn. It is common in area of the neck and in the ear lobes. Hypertrophic scar. So hypertrophic scar is structurally similar to keloid. However, hypertrophic scar never gets to worse after 6 months, unlike keloid, which gets worse even after a year, or some may even progress from 5 to 10 years. Following excision, keloids recur, whereas a hypertrophic scar does not. Now I am coming to discuss with you excessive contraction. A decrease in the synthesis in the size of a wound depends on the presence of myofibroblasts. Development of cell contracts and sustained cell contraction and exaggeration of these processes is termed contractor restriction and result in severe deformity of a wound and surrounding tissue. Contractor cystrication is also said to arise as a result of the late reduction in the size of the wound. Interestingly, the region that normally show minimal wound contraction, such as the form, the sole and the interior aspect of the thorax are the one prone to contractures. Contracture are particularly conspicuous in the healing of the seriously burned, contracture of the skin and underlying connective tissue can be severe enough to comprise the movement of joints. Cicatrization is also important in hollow viscera such as urethra, esophagus and intestine. It leads to progressive stenosis and stricture formation. In the elementary tract, a contracture stricture can result in the obstruction to the passage of the food. In the esophagus are a block in the flow of the intestinal contract. Several diseases are characterized by contracture and irreversible fibrosis of the superficial fascia, including Dupuytren's disease, palmar contracture, plantar contracture, and Lederhosen disease and Peyronie disease, contracture of the cavernous tissue of the penis. In these diseases, there is no known precipitating injury, even though the basic process is similar to contracture in wound healing. Miscellaneous implantation or epidermoid cysts, epithelial cells which flow into the healing wound, may later sometime persist and proliferate to form an epidermoid cyst. Fracture healing. The basic process involved in the healing of bone fracture bear many resemblance to those seen in the skin wound healing. Unlike healing, a fracture is repaired not by fibrous scar tissue and but by specialized bone forming tissue, so that under favorable circumstance the bone is restored nearly to normal. Now I am coming to discuss with you structure of bone. Bone is composed of classified osteoid tissue which consists of collagen fiber embedded in the mucoprotein matrix. Osteomucin, depending on the arrangement of the collagen fiber, there are two histological types of bone. On first tip come wound immature or non-lamellar bone. This show irregularity in the arrangement of the collagen bundle and in the distribution of the osteocyte. The osteomucin is less abundant and is also contain less calcium. Now I am coming to discuss with you lamellar or adult bone. So in this type of bone, the collagen bundle are arranged in parallel sheets. Stage in fracture healing, bone regeneration. Stage first is hematoma formation. Immediately following the injury, there is a variable amount of bleeding. From torn vessel, if the periosteum is torn, this blood may extend into the surrounding muscle. If it is subsequently organized and ossified, myostasis ossification result. In stage 2, inflammation occur. The tissue damage excites an inflammatory response that exudates, adding more fibrin to the clots already present. The inflammatory charges differ in no way from those seen in other inflamed tissue. There is an increased blood flow and a polymorphonuclear leukocytic infiltration. The hematoma attained to fusiform shape. On third stage is demolition. Macrophages invade the clot and remove the fibrin red cell. The inflammatory exudate and debris. Any fragment of bone which have become detached from their blood supply undergo necrosis and are attacked by macrophages and osteoclasts. On stage 4, formation of granulation tissue occur. Following this phase of demolition, there is an ingrowth of capillary loops and mesenchymal cells derived from the periosteum and the endosteum of the cancellous bone. These cells have osteogenic potential and together with the newly formed blood vessel contribute to the granulation tissue formation. On stage 5 come wound bone and cartilage formation. The mesenchymal osteoblast next differentiate to form either wound bone or cartilage. The term callus, derived from the Latin and meaning hard, is often used to describe the material uniting the fracture, and regardless of its consistency, when this is granulation tissue, the callus is soft, but as bone or cartilage formation occur, it become hard. On stage 6 come formation of lamellar bone. The decalcified cartilage or worn bone is next invaded by capillaries headed by osteoclasts. As the initial scaffolding provisional callus is removed, osteoblasts lay down osteoid which calcifies to form bone. Its collagen bundles are now arranged in orderly lamellar fashion. For the most part, concentrically around the blood vessel, and in this way, the Haverhill system are formed. Adjacent to the periosteum and endosteum, the lamellae are peripheral to the surface, and as in the normal bone, this phase of formation of definitive lamellar bone merged with the last stage. On stage 7 come is remodeling. The final remodeling process involving the continued osteoclastic removal and osteoblastic laying down of bone resulted in the formation of the bone, which differ remarkably little from the original tissue. The external callus is slowly removed. The intermediate callus become converted into compact bone containing Haverhill system, while the internal callus is hollowed out into a marrow cavity in which only a few spicules of cancellous bone remain. So, goodbye, my dear ladies and gentlemen. If you like my lecture, so please subscribe and press the bell icon and share with others. Hello dear ladies and gentlemen, in today's lecture I am going to discuss with you immunopathology of diseases. Immune system. So what is immune system? Is defined as defense mechanism against microorganism, malfunctioning cell and foreign particle that enter the body. Step of defense mechanism. The first defense mechanism against foreign bodies and microorganism is called non-specific external barrier, i.e. skin, mucous membrane, saliva and HCl in the gastric juice. If these barriers are penetrated, the body responds with innate immune response, i.e. phagocytes and natural killer cell. Inflammation and fever. If the innate immune response is insufficient, the body responds with adaptive immune response, cell-mediated immunity and humoral immunity, non-specific defense mechanism. These are designed to prevent infection by organism like include intact skin, mucus and cilia, phagocyte, etc. Role of the skin. Skin is a strong barrier from microorganism. Moreover, skin cells are constantly sloughed off, make it hard for invading bacteria to colonize. Sweat and oil contain antimicrobial chemical, including some antibiotics. Role of mucus and cilia. Mucus contain lysozyme enzyme that destroy bacterial cell wall. The normal flow of the mucus washes bacteria and viruses off and away from mucus membrane. Cilia in the respiratory tract move mucus out of the lung to keep bacteria and viruses away. Now I am coming to discuss with you role of phagocytes. So what is the main role of phagocytes? Phagocytes are several types of white blood cell, including macrophages and neutrophils, etc., that engulf and destroy invader. Some also engulf damaged body cell, phagocyte, or attracted by an inflammatory response of damaged cell. Now I am coming to discuss with you rules of inflammation. So what is the main rule of inflammation? Purpose of inflammation is to get rid of the microorganism and to wash out toxin and bacteria. In the exudates fluid rule of fever, the temperature of the tissue may rise, which can kill temperature-sensitive microbes. Fever is a defense mechanism that can destroy many types of microbes. Fever also helps in the fight of viral infection by increasing interferon production. Now I am coming to discuss with you rules of innate immune system. A general response to anything other than a previously recognized antigen. So it is non-specific response only to the post-exposure. The most important cell working in the innate immunity include neutrophil, eosinophil, mast cell, basophil, natural killer cell, and dendritic cell. All these cells have receptor for pathogen. They are for not in need of previous recognition of AGSNK. Natural killer cell has the natural ability to lyse tumor cell, virally infected cell, and IgG-coated targeted cell. Specific defense mechanism. Specific defense are those that give us immunity against certain diseases. The immune system forms memory data for the invading microbes. If the microbe is encountered again, the body reacts so quickly and spatially that few or no symptoms are felt. Major player in specific immunity are macrophages, T cell helpers, cytotoxic memory, B cell, plasma memory, and antibodies. Adaptive immune system, a specific immune system form against an unknown foreign antigen that is previously recognized using stored data, memory cell. More cellular or humoral immune response is induced. Now I am coming to discuss with you antibodies. So what is antibody? Antibodies are protein produced by the human immune system to detect specific invasive microbes for destruction. Now I am coming to discuss with you antigen. So what is antigen? Antigen is any protein that our immune system can recognize. It may be self or non-self antigen. Specific antibodies are formed to block specific antigen. Lymphocyte in the immune response. Lymphocyte are two types, T and B lymphocytes. B cell mature in the bone marrow, then concentrate in the lymph node and the spleen and produce antibodies. T cell mature in the thymus. B and T cell that circulates in the blood and lymphs. Circulation ensures that come into the contact and with pathogen. B lymphocyte, there are more than 10 million different B lymphocyte, each of which makes a different antibodies that is specific to one antigen. The huge variety is caused by gene coding for ABS changing site. There are a small group of B lymphocyte from which antibodies do not live and are embedded in the plasma membrane of the cell, called antibodies receptor. When the receptor in the membrane recognizes an antigen on the surface of the pathogen, the B cell divide rapidly, as we shown in the figure. B cell first divide into two plasma and memory cell. A memory cell then further divide to antibodies production. First of all, CD4 cell cytokine to B cell, and B cell then activated. Divide into activated B cell and then further. Some activated B cell give rise to plasma cell. These produce lots of antibodies which travel to a blood, lymphs, lining of the guts and lungs. Then after a few weeks, number of the plasma cell number go down while antibodies stay in the blood longer. But eventually their number go down too. Some activated B cell become memory cell. Memory cells are able to divide rapidly as soon as the antigen is reintroduced once more. When the pathogen infects again, it is destroyed before any symptoms appear. Now I am going to discuss with you antibodies. So what is antibodies? Antibodies are also known as immunoglobulins. Structure and types of antibodies. Antibodies are composed of a heavy and light chain of polypeptides. The chains are held together by disulfide bridges. Antibodies are made up of two identical light chains and two identical heavy chains. Each light chain bound to a heavy chain to disulfide bond, HL. Also heavy chain to heavy chain by disulfide bond. There are five basic patterns per heavy chain: alpha, beta, gamma, and etc. To give five types of immunoglobulin: IgM, IgG, IgA, IgE, and IgD. Consecutively, antigen binding site. Each AB has two identical AG binding site or FAB portion for binding to specific AG. Depending on the amino acid sequence and very specific to its AG, also called variable region, the order of amino acid in the variable region determines the shape of the binding site, which makes it fit the AG just like a key and lock. Now I am coming to discuss with you a cellular binding site. So what is cellular binding site? Cellular binding site, also each AB has FC receptor for binding to cell, e.g. macrophage, basophil, etc. And to the complement system, how ABS work? Some act as a label to identify antigen and kill the phagocyte, other work is antitoxin, i.e. the block toxin, e.g. diphtheria and tetanus toxin, while other attract to bacterial flagella, making them less active and easier for phagocyte to engulf, and some cause agglutination, clumping together of bacteria, making them less likely to spread. Immunoglobulin function, IgM, the first antibody to produce very effective against microorganism, an agglutinating antigen. It is the pentamer and cannot pass through the placenta. IgG enhance phagocyte, neutralize viruses and toxin, passes through placenta and protect fetus and newborn. It is a monomer. IgA provide localized protection on mucosal surface. It is dimer and cannot pass through the placenta. IgE monomer and fixed to basophil, and eosinophil responsible for allergy and the killing of parasite. T lymphocyte, T cell lymphocyte has T cell receptor TCR, which have a very similar structure of antibodies. Variable region FAB and are specific to one antigen. They become activated when the receptor come into contact with AG on the antigen presenting cell, e.g. a macrophage membrane or invading cell. After activation, the cell divide to form the following subtypes: T helper cell, which secrete cytokine to help B cell proliferation and stimulate macrophages to secrete more cytokines. Cytokine T cell which kill cell bound to a specific ABS, e.g. virally infected cell. Suppressor T cell which inhibit further immune response, i.e. negative feedback mechanism on the immune system. Memory T cell, these cell remain in the circulation waiting for reinfection with the same microorganism, then it will divide and give activated T cell and the process start again. Goodbye, dear ladies and gentlemen. If you have any question about this topic, please ask in the comments. And if you like, please subscribe and share with other and press the bell icon. Please, if you have any question about this topic, you can ask me in the comments. Okay. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajeem. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Hello dear ladies and gentlemen, in today's lecture I am going to discuss with you immunopathology of diseases. Immune system. So what is immune system? Is defined as defense mechanism against microorganism, malfunctioning cell and foreign particle that enter the body, step of defense mechanism. The first defense mechanism against foreign bodies and microorganism is called non-specific external barrier, i.e. skin, mucous membrane, saliva and HCl in the gastric juice. If these barriers are penetrated, the body responds with innate immune response, i.e. phagocytes and natural killer cell. Inflammation and fever. If the innate immune response is insufficient, the body responds with adaptive immune response, cell-mediated immunity, and humoral immunity, non-specific defense mechanism. These are designed to prevent infection by organism like include intake skin, mucus and cilia, phagocyte, etc. Role of the skin. Skin is a strong barrier from microorganism. Moreover, skin cells are constantly sloughed off, make it hard for invading bacteria to colonize. Sweet and oil contain antimicrobial chemical, including some antibiotics. Role of mucus and cilia. Mucus contain lysozyme enzyme that destroy bacterial cell wall. The normal flow of the mucus washes bacteria and viruses up and away from mucous membrane. Cilia in the respiratory tract move mucus out of the lung to keep bacteria and viruses away. Now I am coming to discuss with you role of phagocytes. So what is the main role of phagocytes? Phagocytes are several types of white blood cell, including macrophages and neutrophils, etc., that engulf and destroy invader. Some also engulf damaged body cell. Phagocytes are attracted by an inflammatory response of damaged cell. Now I am coming to discuss with you rules of inflammation. So what is the main role of inflammation? Purpose of inflammation is to get rid of the microorganism and to wash out toxin and bacteria. In the exudates fluid rule of fever, the temperature of the tissue may rise, which can kill temperature sensitive microbes. Fever is a defense mechanism that can destroy many types of microbes. Fever also help in the fight of viral infection by increasing interferon production. Now I am coming to discuss with you roles of innate immune system. A general response to anything other than a previously recognized antigen. So it is non-specific response only to the post exposure. The most important cell working in the innate immunity include neutrophil, eosinophil, mast cell, basophil, natural killer cell, and dendritic cell. All these cells have receptor for pathogen, therefore not in need of previous recognition of AGSNK. Natural killer cell has the natural ability to lyse tumor cell, virally infected cell, and IgG-coated targeted cell. Specific defense mechanism. Specific defense are those that give us immunity against certain diseases. The immune system forms memory data for the invading microbes. If the microbe is encountered again, the body reacts so quickly and spatially that few or no symptoms are felt. Major player in specific immunity are macrophages, T cell, helpers, cytotoxic memory, B cell, plasma memory, and antibodies. Adaptive immune system, a specific immune system formed against an unknown foreign antigen that is previously recognized using stored data, memory cell. More cellular or humoral immune response is induced. Now I am coming to discuss with you antibodies. So what is antibody? Antibodies are protein produced by the human immune system to detect specific invasive microbes for destruction. Now I am coming to discuss with you antigen. So what is antigen? Antigen is any protein that our immune system can recognize. It may be self or non-self antigen. Specific antibodies are formed to block specific antigen. Lymphocyte in the immune response. Lymphocyte are two types, T and B lymphocytes. B cell mature in the bone marrow, then concentrate in the lymph node and the spleen and produce antibodies. T cell mature in the thymus. B and T cell that circulates in the blood and lymphs. Circulation ensure that come into the contact and with pathogen. B lymphocyte, there are more than 10 million different B lymphocytes, each of which makes are different antibodies that is specific to one antigen. The huge variety is caused by gene coding for ABS changing site. There are a small group of B lymphocytes from which antibodies do not live and are embedded in the plasma membrane of the cell called antibodies receptor. When the receptor in the membrane recognizes an antigen on the surface of the pathogen, the B cell divide rapidly as we shown in the figure. B cell first divide into two plasma and memory cell. A memory cell then further divide to antibodies production. First of all, CD4 cell cytokine to B cell, and B cell then activated, divide into activated B cell, and then further. Some activated B cell give rise to plasma cell. These produce lots of antibodies which travel to a blood lymph lining of the guts and lungs. Then after a few weeks, number of the plasma cell number go down while antibodies stay in the blood longer. But eventually their number go down too. Some activated B cell become memory cell. Memory cell are able to divide rapidly as soon as the antigen is reintroduced once more. When the pathogen infects again, it is destroyed before any symptoms appear. Now I am going to discuss with you antibodies. So what is antibodies? Antibodies are also known as immunoglobulin structure and types of antibodies. Antibodies are composed of a heavy and light chain of polypeptides. The chains are held together by disulfide bridges. Antibodies are made up of two identical light chains and two identical heavy chains. Each light chain bound to a heavy chain to disulfide bond HL. Also heavy chain to heavy chain by disulfide bond. There are five basic patterns per heavy chain: alpha, beta, gamma, and etc. To give five types of immunoglobulin: IgM, IgG, IgA, IgE, and IgD. Consecutively, antigen binding site. Each AB has two identical AG binding site or FAB portion for binding to specific AG. Depending on the amino acid sequence and very specific to its AG, also called variable region, the order of immune acid in the variable region determines the shape of the binding site, which makes it fit the AG just like a key and lock. Now I am coming to discuss with you a cellular binding site. So what is cellular binding site? Cellular binding site, also each AB has FC receptor for binding to cell, e.g. macrophage, basophil, etc. And to the complement system, how ABS work. Some act as a label to identify antigen and kill the phagocyte. Other work is antitoxin, i.e. the block toxin, e.g. diphtheria and tetanus toxin, while other attract to bacterial flagella, making them less active and easier for phagocyte to engulf, and some cause agglutination, clumping together of bacteria, making them less likely to spread. Immunoglobulin function, IgM, the first antibody to produce very effective against microorganism, and agglutinating antigen, it is the pentamer and cannot pass through the placenta. IgG enhance phagocyte, neutralize viruses and toxin, passes through placenta and protect fetus and newborn. It is a monomer. IgA provide localized protection on mucosal surface. It is dimer and cannot pass through the placenta. IgE monomer and fixed to basophil, and eosinophil responsible for allergy and the killing of parasite. T lymphocyte, T cell lymphocyte has T cell receptor TCR, which have a very similar structure of antibodies variable region FAB and are specific to one antigen. They become activated when the receptor come into contact with AG on the antigen presenting cell, e.g. a macrophage membrane or invading cell. After activation, the cell divide to form the following subtypes: T helper cell, which secrete cytokine to help B cell proliferation and stimulate macrophages to secrete more cytokines. Cytokine T cell which kill cell bound to a specific ABS, e.g. virally infected cell. Suppressor T cell which inhibit further immune response, i.e. negative feedback mechanism on the immune system. Memory T cell, these cell remain in the circulation waiting for reinfection with the same microorganism, then it will divide and give activated T cell and the process start again. Goodbye, dear ladies and gentlemen. If you have any question about this topic, please ask in the comments. And if you like, please subscribe and share with other and press the bell icon. Please, if you have any question about this topic, you can ask me in the comments. Okay.